President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s attendance at the Formula One Grand Prix in Singapore, but it says his recent trip to the neighboring country was productive.
President Marcos leads the groundbreaking ceremony for two stations of the country's first ever subway system.
The Philippine peso falls to a new record low against the U.S. dollar after closing at the 59 level.
And the number of deaths due to Hurricane Ian, which pummeled the U.S., hits 83.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crew.
And I'm Denise Insai. You're watching Top Story.
After facing stern criticisms, Malacanang finally speaks up about Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s recent trip to Singapore. On Facebook, Press Secretary Trixie Cruz Angeles said that visit was productive as it reinforced commitments made during the president's state visit to Singapore last month. But it triggered backlash, with Marcos attending the Formula One Grand Prix as the Philippines reels from Super Typhoon Carding. Also with him, his son, Ilocos Norte Representative Sandro Marcos, and First Lady Lisa Araneta Marcos, as shown in a photo posted by Singaporean Prime Minister Lee Hsien Loong. Some photos also showed his cousin, House Speaker Martin Romualdez, in the event. Malacanang did not disclose that trip and was mum when asked about the visit throughout the weekend.
Malacanang's confirmation of the president's weekend trip came hours after a Singaporean official posted about it on Facebook. Singapore's Minister for Manpower, Tan Si Leng, shared a photo of him with Marcos at the exclusive F1 paddock club. But Tan clarified he also met with other heads of states on the sidelines of the race to affirm bilateral economic ties. The Singapore visit was the fourth known foreign trip of Marcos since taking his oath in June. The first two were state visits to Indonesia and Singapore. He also went to the U.S. last month for a working visit.
House Majority Leader Jose Manuel Dalipe defends the president's trip to Singapore. He sees nothing wrong with it, saying all leaders of Southeast Asian nations were invited to Singapore to attend the Formula One Grand Prix.
If you can recall, in the recent trip, pumunta sila ng Indonesia, pumunta ang ating mahal na Pangulo sa Singapore, and I think that is where that invitation was relayed. So hindi lang si mahal na Pangulo Bongbong Marcos ang naimbita sa Singapore for that event, but also other leaders from other parts of Southeast Asia. And I think it so happened that it is an event for them to get together and socialize.
But for House Deputy Minority Leader Franz Castro, Marcos' Singapore Grand Prix trip was insensitive and callous in light of the suffering of Filipinos. Castro adds if Marcos indeed used government resources for what she calls an extravagant junket, it would be like a punch in the gut of hungry Filipinos.
Progressive group Bayan also says the president's visit to Singapore and Malacanang's seeming attempt to keep it under wraps is unacceptable. Bayan Secretary General Renato Reyes Jr. says the Marcos administration should be more transparent about details of the trip.
First news reports that came out, it was a private jet. Then later on, we saw posts on Facebook saying that it was a Philippine Air Force asset which was used. Mm-hmm. It was a $2 billion Gulfstream, 2 billion peso Gulfstream jet, supposedly with command and control capabilities. Who are paying for the other people on the president's entourage? His son was there, the House Speaker was there, another member of the House was also seen at the place. They had plus ones. So who are paying for these? Tayo ba, taxpayers? In a time when public debt has breached 13 trillion pesos, if it was official, then they should have announced it early on. Why the silence? Why the secrecy? Why the afterthought? No? Issuing statements already when there was public uproar.
A group of farmers also slams President Marcos for going to Singapore to watch a lavish Grand Prix amid mounting economic problems here at home. The Kilusang Magbubukid ng Pilipinas called this trip shameful as the country continues to deal with the devastation left by Super Typhoon Karding. It adds Marcos, who is also the Agriculture Secretary, should have spent more time finding ways to help those affected by the storm. Karding damaged 3 billion pesos worth of agriculture products and affected 104,500 farmers across Luzon.
Meanwhile, netizens had a field day weighing in on President Marcos's trip to Singapore to watch the F1 race. This user points out billionaires watch F1 races and that the best time to ask them for investments is when they're happy and excited. But Dr. Tony Leachon doubts that argument as he asks, where's the economic team to take down notes and pledges, and why was there no formal send-off from the airport? Cartoonist Zach, meanwhile, drew an illustration suggesting the president's priorities, while user Jojo Clemente wonders what would typhoon victims feel upon seeing photos of the president and his relatives seemingly enjoying themselves in Singapore. After drawing flak for his weekend trip to Singapore, President Marcos leads the groundbreaking ceremony for two stations of the country's first ever subway system. Katrina Domingo filed this report.
The groundbreaking ceremony led by President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. earlier today signals the start of the construction of the Metro Manila Subway project, which officials are now touting as the crown jewel of Philippine transportation. In his speech earlier, President Marcos underscored that the 33-kilometer subway, which is expected to have 17 stations, will cut travel time from Taguig to Valenzuela to 35 minutes. The price tag, 488 billion pesos, which will be funded by loans from the Japan International Cooperation Agency. The project, which is set to be completed by 2028, is expected to accommodate at least 519,000 passengers daily and generate some 18,000 jobs in the next 6 years.
We fervently hope to soon enjoy the benefits that it brings to the general public, with accessible designated stations that can cater to a massive volume of passengers. We anticipate helping our people skip the long lines of traffic and even spare themselves from the perils of commuting.
Marcos says the Metro Manila Subway project will show investors that the Philippines is on its way to greater heights after the COVID-19 pandemic.
Let the breaking ground of this subway system signal our intention to the world to pursue even grander dreams and more ambitious endeavors that will bring comfort and progress to our people all over the country. Be assured that this administration will take the lead in identifying, pursuing, and implementing projects as part of the Build Better, More Infrastructure agenda that we have laid out.
President Marcos did not open the floor to questions, so we were not able to ask him about his weekend getaway to Singapore to watch the Formula One Grand Prix.
Now, in line with that project, a section of Meralco Avenue along Ortigas will be closed starting at 9 this evening to give way for the subway's construction. The closure will last for 6 years until the project's target completion in 2028. Authorities warn of heavy traffic while construction is ongoing.
Yung iba medyo kinakabahan po sa traffic dahil sa pagsara ng Meralco Avenue, pero ito naman po ay panandaliang sakripisyo para sa mas maliwanag na kinabukasan, konting sakripisyo po ngayon para sa ginhawa, para sa kaginhawaan pagdating ng bukas.
The fare hike across public utility vehicles in the Philippines takes effect today. But transport leaders say many PUV drivers won't be able to implement it since they have yet to receive their new fare matrix from transport regulators. Based on the LTFRB's tally, they have only released 400 fare matrices, or 1.18% of the more than 39,000 target vehicles.
Baka pwede i-simplify yung pagkuha ng fare matrix. Ayon sa mga naglalakad, yung franchise verification ang nagpapatagal kasi mahabang pila. Submit ka na sana ng mga dokumento, wala na sana yung franchise verification kasi nasa kanila naman yung record.
The Transportation Department, meanwhile, defends the fare hike despite weeks of rollbacks in local pump prices.
Dahil may inflation, no, ay kailangan din naman natin sila sigurong bigyan ng maliit na increase ng pamasahe, no. Alam niyo po, matagal na silang nanghihingi ng increase ng pamasahe, pero dahil nagkaroon ng pandemya, ay hindi muna natin sila binigyan itong mga increase na ito para naman hindi masyadong mahirapan yung ating mga pasahero.
Beginning today, the minimum fare for traditional and modern jeepneys will be increased by 1 peso, while buses were granted a 2 peso hike. Flag down rates for taxis and transport network vehicle services also raised by 5 pesos.
Meanwhile, a commuters group says it understands the need for a fare hike, but the National Center for Commuter Safety and Protection hopes there won't be any more price increases in the near future.
Papasalamat po kami sa DOTR at saka sa ating LTFRB. Binigyan halaga po nila yung ating opinion kasi marami, mayroon pong mga paksyon na ang gusto ay gawin pang 15 pesos ang ating lowest, yung minimum fare, no? Salamat na lang at binigyan halaga nila yung ating opinion na ito ay gawin lamang ng maliit sapagkat hindi na talaga kakayanin.
Local pump prices are headed lower for the fifth straight week Tuesday. Kerosene prices will see the biggest rollback of 85 centavos per liter. Diesel prices will be slashed by 45 centavos per liter, while a liter of gasoline will be 40 centavos cheaper. An industry expert has said the rollback this week could have been bigger if it weren't for the weakness of the Philippine peso against the U.S. dollar.
Philippine Senator Pia Cayetano seeks clarity over the proposed 150 million peso confidential fund under the Education Department's budget for 2023. Cayetano notes this is her first time to hear that the agency is seeking such funds. She says she wants the Education Department to explain how the budget will be utilized. Vice President and Education Secretary Sara Duterte has said the funds will be used to address issues such as sexual grooming, as well as insurgency recruitment and drug involvement of students.
Kung sasabihin naman yung purpose, maganda naman yung purpose, mm-hmm. no? Na yung to protect the learners. I understand. I'm just trying to get a better grasp on whether they handle these actual protective steps such that they have to handle this kind of funding. And does it have to be that much?
Meanwhile, a Philippine House leader is mum on calls to realign Vice President Duterte's confidential funds. House Majority Leader Manuel De Lipe says they can find other sources of funding for other education-related programs. He adds Congress will look for funds for government projects with zero funding in the 2023 national budget.
I am one with him for additional budget for the classrooms, but not necessarily naman kukunin sa confidential funds, because when the Vice President was here during the sponsorship of the budget of our department, the Department of Education, clear naman kay Vice President Secretary Sara Duterte yung purpose ng confidential funds. And if there is a need to add more funds for classrooms, then we will add accordingly. Definitely, there will be changes on that. Hindi naman masi zero. We will propose that. The instruction of Speaker Ferdinand Martin Romualdez is to see to it that when we forward it or when we transmit it to the Senate, maayos na lahat.
A House lawmaker wants actors to undergo mandatory drug tests before they can take on any acting project. That proposal from Surigao del Norte 2nd District Representative Robert Barbers came following the arrest of actor Dominic Rocco and four companions in a buy-bust operation. Barbers, who chairs the House Committee on Dangerous Drugs, adds, he has also encouraged his fellow lawmakers to set an example and take drug tests voluntarily.
The past several years, ay meron pong mga iniidolo ng bayan na mga artista na talagang nasangkot sa illegal na droga. At sa aking palagay, ito ay makaka-impluensya sa ating mga kabataan. Yan naman po ay hindi unconstitutional. Meron pong ruling ang Supreme Court dyan na
meanwhile, Police Chief Rodolfo Azurin Jr. welcomes the lawmaker's proposal to make drug tests for artists mandatory. He says celebrities should serve as a good example to the public.
For Senator Robin Padilla, drug tests should not be mandatory. Robin, who was an actor, clarifies he supports efforts to protect the public, including artists, from dangers of using illegal drugs, but he believes it should not be a requirement as it may be a violation of human rights. Each Filipino now has a debt burden of about 118,000 pesos as the national government's outstanding debt hits 13 trillion. Senators learned this during a budget hearing with the Finance Department. Now let's get more details from our correspondent Jackie Pascual, who joins us now on the line. Jackie?
Hi, Ron. A newborn child in the Philippines already has a debt of about 118,000 pesos each. At the hearing of the Senate Committee on Finance on the budget of the Department of Finance, the Bureau of Treasury said 110 million Filipinos now has a debt burden of 118,000 pesos each. National Treasurer Rosalia de Leon revealed the debt of the Philippines is now about 13 trillion pesos as of August 2022. This is double than the debt 6 years ago, largely due to the COVID-19 related expenses. De Leon added that for 2023 or for next year, the Philippines would have to pay 1.5 trillion pesos just for debt. This includes the 1 trillion pesos in principal and interest of about 580 billion pesos. Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel said with a huge amount, the country should generate more revenues. The Department of Finance targets to generate 3.6 trillion pesos for 2023, a big chunk from the Bureau of Internal Revenue and the Bureau of Customs. Finance Secretary Benjamin Jokno presented to the committee the agency's proposed budget of 30.6 billion pesos, including those for attached agencies. Jokno also reiterated calls for taxes on online sales for additional revenues. The BIR added it is not targeting small businesses only, but all businesses, including the medium and large companies. And that's the latest. Ron, back to you.
Jackie Pascual with that story. Thanks, Jackie.
Philippine Senator Jinggoy Estrada welcomes government's decision to cancel more than 48,000 visas of Chinese employees working under Philippine offshore gaming operators whose licenses were revoked. Estrada notes this is in line with his earlier remark urging for a crackdown on unlicensed POGOs. He says there are no economic gains in their continuing operations and adds it would be unfair to other POGOs which are operating legally. Over the weekend, the Justice Department said authorities would just cancel alien visas instead of deporting the involved Chinese nationals. It says doing so would be more cost-efficient. The involved Chinese nationals are given 59 days to voluntarily exit the country.
Military forces of the Philippines and the U.S. are embarking on a series of military exercises in the next 10 days. Our correspondent Bianca Dava joins us on the line for more details. Bianca?
Hi, Ron. Yes, this morning, Philippine Marine Corps began its sixth iteration of the Kamandag exercises with the United States Marine Corps at the Philippine Navy Officers Club in Taguig City. Kamandag, which translates to Cooperation of the Warriors of the Sea, will be conducted in various training areas in Luzon from October 3 to 14. Last year, participants were drastically reduced due to the COVID-19 pandemic, and most of the activities were held virtually. But this year, events will be done face-to-face. Philippine Navy Acting Flag Officer in Command, Rear Admiral Cesar Bernard Valencia, noted this will also be the first time that military personnel from the Japan Ground Self-Defense Force and the Republic of Korea Marine Corps will participate in the exercises, but only as observers. This year's Kamandag aims to rehearse emerging concepts such as humanitarian assistance and disaster response, while strengthening the relationship and interoperability between the Philippine and U.S. military forces, as well as their Japanese and Korean counterparts. The exercise will also focus on enhancing capabilities in special operations, coastal defense, and chemical, biological, radiological, and nuclear operations. A total of 3,760 military personnel will participate in the Kamandag exercises. The Philippines and the U.S. have a mutual defense treaty signed in 1951, which states that both nations are to defend each other in case of an armed attack by a third-party country. The two countries' armed forces hold a number of joint exercises and trainings annually, including the Kamandag and the Balikatan exercises. Back to you, Ron.
Thank you very much, Bianca Dava.
The Philippine Charity Sweepstakes Office asserts there are no irregularities in their grand lotto draw over the weekend. 433 bettors won, and they are splitting the 236 million peso prize. The winning combination was also quite unique, consisting of multiples of nine. But PCSO General Manager Mel Robles says, while the results are indeed extraordinary, at the end of the day, Lotto is a game of chance.
Your chance or the odds of winning is 1 over 28.9 million. The science stops there. No? Wala na, after that, it's all pure, unadulterated luck. We are very transparent with the machine. Hangin po yan. The balls are carefully weighed. They should have an exact weight. Prior to Saturday, marami talaga palang nag-aalaga ng ganyan. Ng series of nine. No? Yes. We check. Isang check namin, umabot ng halos 300 bettors.
The controversial lottery result prompted minority senators to call for a probe. They say they want to ensure the lottery system here in the Philippines is glitch-free.
Marami ang nagsabi na katakata ang resulta nito. Maibotin natin yung mga PCSO Lotto. Kasi official games ito eh. Na pangalan ng Republika ng Pilipinas ang daladala rito o nakataya rito. So ipakita natin na merong integridad yung ating mga Lotto games.
The results of the 655 Grand Lotto draw may not be as surprising as it initially seems. UP Applied Mathematics Professor Jomar Abahante points out, it is not unusual for people to bet on multiples of nine.
If we're going to look at the numbers, the multiples of nine, no, lucky nine. So very common itong, it possibly very common itong piliin ng mga tao. And if you're going to look at the ticket, yung ginuguhitan nila, nasa diagonal. So the pattern is really there. And actually, there's a study in Netherlands, no, in 2016. That multiple of nine is very common also in Netherlands, natayaan ng mga tao.
Another mathematics professor says, while unlikely, it is not completely impossible that 433 bettors won the jackpot prize. But he agrees the Senate should still look into the matter.
Kahit ilang bilyong taon na gagawin natin yung loto, ay yung ano, pagpupusta, parang hindi natin in-expect na mangyayari itong
yun.
Ganito. Pero hindi naman natin sinasabing imposible. Ang gusto ko lang sabihin ay tulad sa mga ano, sa mga casinos, kanyang sa Pagcor, ganun. Pag may nangyaring kakaiba na ano, na out of the realm of probability, ay ininvestigahan nila or gumagawa sila ng audit.
Up next, U.S. President Joe Biden set to visit hurricane-hit areas.
And Philippine shares see a strong start to the new trading week. More news when we return.
With more news, a data analytics expert projects daily COVID cases in the Philippines will stand at around 2,000 until the end of the year. Professor Jomar Abahante of the UP Pandemic Response Team says this just proves the health crisis is not yet over. Abahante also urges authorities not to let their guard down against the threat of the disease.
The number of cases will just hover around these numbers, around 2,000. Mm-hmm. Even before we are projecting that this kind of dynamic will happen even until the end of 2022. Which implies that hindi pa tapos yung pandemic, there are still people getting COVID. But the good news is the hospitalizations are... we can already handle the capacity compared to what happened in 2020 and 2021. But what we are seeing is that we need to continue monitoring because in other countries, they are forecasting that in this coming fall or in winter, there might be more people getting COVID.
The amount of unreleased benefits for healthcare workers has reached 64 billion pesos. The Health Department made the confirmation during the agency's 2023 budget deliberation at the Senate. DOH officer in charge, Maria Rosario Vergere, says they are doing everything they can for the immediate release of funds. Groups of health workers had been holding protests to demand the release of their COVID allowances and benefits.
We had been communicating to the Department of Budget and Management for the release of additional funds for our healthcare workers.
Is it safe to say, ma'am, before Christmas, makukuha na nilang kanilang hazard pay?
Hopefully, I mean, Senator Tulfo, we're doing everything we can so that the budget will be provided to DOH and we can download to our operating facility. So,
an update on the aftermath of Typhoon Karding. Philippine Social Welfare Chief Erwin Tulfo says more evacuees have returned home over the weekend, days after the storm pounded Luzon. But he says the distribution of relief assistance is ongoing in typhoon-hit areas. So far, 53 million pesos worth of assistance has already been given to storm victims. Tulfo also recognizes the need to improve the country's social protection programs.
Just training and training ng mga tao natin, and of course we really have to adapt this technique kasi nga because of the changing of the environment, world climate change na tinatawag. Of course, nababago na because of the internet. Maraming pagbabago eh. Kaya marami naman tumutulong sa atin. Fortunately, nandyan yung ADB, nandyan yung World Bank teaching us new techniques, technology on how to adapt with the changing times. Sabi nga ng Pangulong Marcos sa amin nung last cabinet meeting, we have to be ready kasi biro mo, from a simple storm, itong Carding na sinasabing mahina, nasa 50-60 kilometers, in just a two-day time, three days, paglapag din sa Pilipinas, that's 160 kilometers per hour yung lakas. And that is because of climate change. Pagkatapos, may mga ibang bagyo pa tayo, may pumapasok na bagyo rito, may hila-hila na another bagyo. Dapat talaga tayo, we have to be ready to respond to any eventualities.
Over in the U.S., the death toll from Hurricane Ian climbs to at least 83. That number is expected to rise as search and rescue efforts continue. Most of the reported fatalities came from Florida, where the storm flattened neighborhoods, submerged towns in floods, and knocked out power lines. Ian is one of the most powerful storms to hit the U.S.
And for Hurricane Ian, it was largely the helicopter operations that were hoisting people out of this harmful, hazardous, destroyed area that we've seen over the last several days. So our job has been, during Ian, to spot those people, locate those people, and then get an asset helicopter on scene to hoist those people out.
Hurricane Ian made landfall in Florida as catastrophic Category 4 storm last week. It then headed to South Carolina as a Category 1 hurricane.
U.S. President Joe Biden set to visit hurricane-hit areas this week. Biden will first visit Puerto Rico Monday, where thousands are still without power 2 weeks after Hurricane Fiona ripped through the island. He will also travel to Florida Wednesday to see Hurricane Ian's devastation.
Our hearts, to state the obvious, it can't go without saying, are heavy. The devastating hurricane, the storms in Puerto Rico, Florida, and South Carolina. And we owe Puerto Rico a hell of a lot more than they've already gotten.
Philippine shares see a strong start to the new trading week, month, and quarter. The details in this report.
The final quarter of 2022 kicked off on Monday with risk assets like stocks struggling as oil jumped 3% on speculation OPEC and its allies will cut output by 1 million barrels a day, its biggest output cut since 2020. As for Philippine shares, the PSE index swung between gains and losses, eventually closing up 0.75% for the day at 57.83. Value turnover still anemic at sub 4%. BDO Capital's Ed Francisco says, while downward pressure is still present, there are bright spots in the local market, while Nisha Alizer tells investors to watch volumes.
We're at a two-year low, as you mentioned, mainly foreign selling. I guess the bright spots really are the fact that the locals are still buying from institutional to retail. They know that it's bargain buys because we're cheaper than we were pre-pandemic already, I think. So it's, except the only concern there is that if U.S. interest rates go up again and then we don't match it, peso will depreciate, so it will, you know, their interest. It's really sentiment.
Now, an ascending volume on an up day might mean that we still have to regain more confidence in terms of the market's recovery. We're at about 12 to 13 times from an average 10-year mean of 17 to 18 times for the market. So definitely attractive.
As for global investment bankers Stephen Ku Unhyang, both less liquidity and higher rates will naturally make the U.S. dollar even mightier. And ultimately, it becomes a tough choice for policymakers.
A year ago, you would get nothing for your dollar deposits.
And let's assume today you'll get what? 4.2% for a two-year deposit. Won't you require more to stay in any other currency?
Yeah.
So there. Now, what does it mean? What does a big manufacturing exporting country do? They say, okay, we ride the flow a little bit because we'll then make a little more money. Mm-hmm. Now, if you're an import driven where all you do is export people and have BPOs country like us, what do? You're going to cause a lot of really terrible inflation if your peso weakens substantially, but you're going to cause economic pain if you raise interest rates to defend the peso, so that from a return-to-return parity, choosing between cholera and the plague.
In corporate stories, Nickel Asia raises its stake in Coral Bay Nickel Corporation in Palawan to 15.6% from 10%. Coral Bay Nickel operates a high-pressure acid leach processing plant in Palawan, processing metals from lateritic nickel ore. Nickel Asia is buying some 33 million shares, or nearly $26 million, or 1.5 billion pesos, from majority shareholder Sumitomo Metal Mining. This investment allows the utilization of cobalt and nickel derived from ore for manufacturing EV batteries. While miner Global Ferronickel is buying 22.22% of GHGC Holdings for $75 million, or around 4.5 billion pesos, giving it a 20% indirect ownership in Guangdong Century Nickel Industry, which owns a value-added processing facility for nickel ore. GCTN operates one of the world's advanced smelters in a 33-hectare facility with over 600 employees. This is part of the company's strategy to diversify towards high-growth firms and industries that can provide synergies and improve cost efficiencies by going up the vertical. The payment will be made by offsetting receivables of around $23 million, while the remaining balance of 52 million pesos will be paid in cash installments. In other news, Megawide's sister company, CITIC Tor Energy REIT, or C-REIT, has filed with the Securities and Exchange Commission the registration for its proposed 3 billion peso green bond issuance with an oversubscription option of 1.5 billion pesos. And finally, there's a growing corporate movement to get the net zero carbon emissions. EDC-led Net Zero Carbon Alliance, which marks its first anniversary, is urging companies to rethink operations and to consciously aim for a sustainable recovery from the pandemic.
Being able to draft our framework, no? Mm-hmm. Which will guide us and the members of NESCA in creating their plans to achieve net zero. And this framework is very simple. No? It's really just to reduce our carbon emissions, and whatever left with the emission, we need to offset it.
100% of our development portfolio by 2030. Mm-hmm. At the moment, we have two operational projects, but we have the commitment to actually grow our portfolio 5 times in 5 years, and we are actually almost done with that. So by the end of the year, or the coming years, we'll have this 5 times growth in our development portfolio. Now, we have 50%, more than actually around 60% of our existing carbon footprint is already decarbonized. We are looking to increasing that in by the end of this year, by around 70 to 80%.
The Philippine peso falls to a new record low against the U.S. dollar. It closed at the 59 level against the greenback. The previous record was 58.99. Further peso depreciation against the dollar is expected as the U.S. Federal Reserve signals more rate hikes in the near term, starting with its meeting in early November. The Philippine Central Bank is also set to hold a monetary policy meeting on November 17.
The U.S. peso still weakening, and so the trend seems to be pointing to possibly higher rates and the peso possibly testing 62. We'll have to catch up with U.S. Fed rates just like with the rest of the world if we want to be able to manage our deficit.
The Philippine Energy Department approves Prime Infrastructure's purchase of Shell's 45% stake in Malampayo Service Contract 38. This after conducting what it calls a thorough review of the transaction. The DOE says Prime Infra was found to be technically, financially, and legally qualified as successor to Shell as operator of the Malampaya Natural Gas Project. Under the deal, Shell Philippines Exploration, or SPX, will become a wholly owned subsidiary of Prime Infra. SPX will continue to operate the Malampaya Service Contract 38. Its mother company, Shell, earlier decided to exit from upstream petroleum activities in the Philippines.
The Philippine Justice Department indicts Japanese tycoon Kazuo Okada, Tony Boy Kuwanko, and two others for grave coercion. It stemmed from their forceful takeover of Okada Manila in May based on a status quo ante order from the Supreme Court. The complaint was filed by Tiger Resort Leisure and Entertainment Incorporated. However, its complaints for slight physical injuries, kidnapping, and serious illegal detention, unjust vexation, and direct assault were dismissed. The Philippine Amusement and Gaming Corporation earlier issued an order reinstating the board of TRLEI.
The Philippine Travel Operators Association, optimistic, the local tourism industry will soon bounce back as soon as they see more Filipinos wanting to travel again. Jackie Pascual reports.
June and Anne are planning a vacation to Boracay for 21 family members, which is why they headed to the Philippine Travel Mart in Pasay to find good tour packages.
Relax, and then a wish ng daughter namin is white sand. So white sand lang yung ano, yung Boracay is.
Most of my family hindi pa nakapunta sa Boracay. So birthday at the same time, treat din namin sa kanila.
They are just some of the many Filipinos who want to travel again. The Philippine Travel Operators Association is confident the tourism sector will rebound following the two-year pandemic. It's also a good time for the Travel Mart as the holiday season approaches.
There's the longing na they want, you know, to reconnect with their families, and also they want to relax. Yeah, with maybe it also it's also aligned with yung sa mental health ng tao.
Halos lahat sobrang na-excite, sobrang gustong mamasyal at pumunta sa iba't ibang lugar.
Aside from the usual tourist spots like Boracay and Cebu, Phil Towa also wants to highlight the not-so-popular destinations. Many of the colorful pavilions at the event are from Mindanao, such as the Bangsamoro and Soksarjen.
Kami ay safe puntahan. Kami sa Sambuanga o sa Mindanao area, ay isang lugar na hindi mo dapat katakutan.
Though COVID restrictions have eased, other challenges are affecting the tourism sector. Low-cost airlines are trying to maintain their prices despite the peso's depreciation against the dollar.
We understand that the forex is really a challenge. Close to 60 pesos na tayo for the dollar. So if you actually travel, so it's going to be, we need to make sure na it's carefully budgeted.
Challenge talaga para sa amin yung rising inflation and at the same time yung weakening of the peso versus the dollar. Kasi most of our operations, it utilizes talaga yung dollar.
Airlines say they still have promo fares to entice people to travel. The Private Sector Advisory Council Tourism Sector, meanwhile, has met with President Marcos as they discuss ways to strengthen domestic tourism, build tourism infrastructure, increase international visitation, and improve the Philippines' image. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine government set to roll out a printable version of the national ID amid delays in the release of the physical cards. Philippine Statistics Authority Chief Dennis Mapa says 1,000 registrants have so far received their electronic Phil IDs under a pilot test in Metro Manila and nearby provinces. He adds a program will soon be expanded across the country. But MAPA says electronic version of the national IDs can only be printed at accredited registration centers. The release of the physical cards has figured in delays attributed to the limited printing capacity of the PSA. President Marcos in July also ordered the fast-tracking of the card's release.
Britain scraps its controversial plan to axe its top income tax rate. Finance Chief Kwasi Kwarteng said he is not proceeding with the move even after Prime Minister Liz Truss recently doubled down on her economic plan. Truss had defended her plan, saying it will support the public through a difficult winter and beyond. But the package was criticized for setting out billions of pounds of spending without offering new sources of government revenue. It also triggered the pound to drop to record lows.
Other news, at least 125 people killed in a riot at a football match in Indonesia. The disaster happened in the early hours of Sunday when fans of Arema FC stormed the pitch after their team lost to bitter rival Persebaya Surabaya. This is one of the world's deadliest stadium disasters. Authorities say many of the victims were trampled on or choked to death. Over 300 people were also injured. Indonesian President Joko Widodo has ordered a safety review of football matches following the tragedy.
The latest now on the conflict in Ukraine. Kyiv says it has claimed full control of the eastern logistics hub of Lyman, its most significant battlefield gain from Russia in weeks. NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg said the recapturing of the town showed Ukraine is capable of dislodging Russian forces with the help of advanced weapons provided by the West. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky said, apart from Lyman, his troops have liberated two other settlements in the Kherson region.
Another setback for Russian President Vladimir Putin. Authorities have sent home around half of the individuals mobilized to fight the war in Ukraine. These men, numbering at thousands, were said to have not met the draft criteria. The region's military commissar was subsequently removed. Putin last month said some 300,000 military reservists would be mobilized to serve in Ukraine. But the move sparked outrage across the country and a mass exodus of eligible men.
At least seven people have now died of cholera in Haiti in a surprise return of the disease. This comes as the nation is paralyzed by a gang blockade that has triggered shortages of fuel and drinking water. Many hospitals have shut down or scaled back operations. A key supplier of bottled water has also stopped production. Cholera is typically spread by water contaminated with the feces of a sick person, which means clean drinking water is critical for preventing its spread.
A new psychological horror film hits the big screen. ABS-CBN's Hollywood correspondent Yong Chavez talked to the cast of Smile in this report.
Once you see it, it's too late is the creepy tagline of Smile, one of the most talked about horror films this year. It stars Sosie Bacon, whose powerhouse performance has been universally praised, including by horror master Stephen King. She plays Rose, a psychiatrist who encounters terrifying occurrences. As the daughter of Kevin Bacon and Kira Sedgwick, the actress is a Hollywood showbiz royalty, but she worked hard for her own success, notably with a breakout performance in the Netflix series 13 Reasons Why and recently in the Prime Video series As We See It.
As its lead star, you know how to internalize the terror. Were there times when you had difficulty shaking off those intense feelings even at the end of the day?
I don't really think I had nightmares like as much as just like it was a general kind of vibe of some like isolation, and that's difficult to shake for sure. But you know, it's a good challenge, and I think everybody who does a horror movie, it's like you gotta remember it's gonna be a lot of nights and there's gonna be some physical stuff.
The movie also features the boy's actor, Jesse T. Usher, as Trevor. He shared how he felt about how something that usually brings joy, like a friendly smile, was effectively used as a vehicle of horror in the movie.
Theoretically, there's a version of the script where we do get to see Trevor do a creepy smile, and like it was already daunting enough. So when they changed that bit, I was happy that I did not have to rehearse it, because I feel like that's something that would like kind of live with you forever. Every time I smile now, I'm wondering, does it look like that creepy one, or is this like the one that I thought was joyful and happy all my life? I don't know.
Kyle Gallner also stars as a police detective who shares a past with Bacon's character.
While the movie does have such dread and this like always ever creeping sense of doom, we wanted to kind of shake things up a little bit and really build real relationship between two people that have known each other for so long that you have moments of them like being annoyed with each other, almost trying to build a little bit of humor to mine out of something like so heavy and so intense. And that to me was a lot of fun, like an interesting challenge.
Smile is written and directed by Parker Finn. Its story is based on a short film that he made in 2020. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.
We have this just in, the 2022 Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine has been awarded to Svante Paabo for his discoveries concerning the genomes of extinct hominins and human evolution. The organization says through his pioneering research, Svante Paabo accomplished something seemingly impossible, sequencing the genome of the Neanderthal, an extinct relative of present-day humans. It adds, Svante Paabo also made the sensational discovery of a previously unknown hominin, Denisova. Paabo also found that gene transfer had occurred from these now extinct hominins to Homo sapiens following the migration out of Africa around 70,000 years ago. The organization says this ancient flow of genes to present-day humans has physiological relevance today, for example, affecting how our immune system reacts to infections. And those are the top stories today. I'm Denise Dinsai.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thank you for watching.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no, and we have allowed more.